I'm going to start by flagging three works. This is an image taken from a project by Katie Patterson about a melting glacier. It's called Vatnajökull, The Sound Of. This is an image from the trailer of Edward Burtynsky's Anthropocene, the Human Epoch. And this is an image taken from Pierre Huyghe's Recollection 2011. It includes a resin mask of La Muse Endormie by Constantin Brancusi. At the beginning of the new century, the current geological age was newly described as a period distinguished by the influence of human activity on the materials and environment of the Earth. In 2002, Paul Crutzen described an in many ways human-dominated geological epoch. It is well documented that there exists a flourishing and at times overdetermined engagement between contemporary artists and new statements by geological science. This paper tries to identify a set of under-recognised possibilities in a reading of the work of British sculptor Lucy Skaer and its relationship to modernism through themes of critical practice, realism and the human. At the centre of Skaer's 2008 work, The Siege, is a set of copies of the series of Constantin Brancusi's 1923 to 1940s Bird in Space. The original sculptures are unearthly, carved in luminescent marble and cast in polished bronze. The work was famously turned by Marcel Duchamp, who had a hand in making known the notes of a United States customs official. The notes queried the validity as art of a shipment of Brancusi's birds, thinking them bars of raw material and without artful likeness to any real-life bird. Brancusi's illustrious work in its chamois sheen and finesse has been subjected to a range of postmodern jokes and indignities. Yet in the beginning, Brancusi's work, architect of its own undoing, shared in a pure critical vision. In 1939, when writing of avant-garde and abstraction, the modernist critic Clement Greenberg revered Brancusi among the artists representing the narrowing and raising of human consciousness above and beyond conditions in culture and in time. Brancusi's bird is the promise of a future undetermined by material conditions. This idea of art, informed by a concept of human reason, articulated in Immanuel Kant's 1781 First Critique, points to the limits of human knowledge, defining human perception as ever correlated to itself. Kant designated a reality inaccessible to humans, and his theories advocated for the sake of advancement and emancipation the rigorous application of human reason to itself. Kant wrote of striving for rational self-criticism. His idea, cited by the modernists, was definitive of their vision of art, which must restrict itself to interrogating the limits of its own knowledge. Celebrated in the play of abstract form, line and colour, and in postmodern form reasserted in a continuous underscoring of the epistemological limit of human reason. From its beginning, critically reflexive art is the enemy of ontological description or speculation, in this asserting the untethered liberty and independence of abstract, self-sufficient and referential human reason and imagination in art. Brancusi's Bird in Space enshrines the potential of human reason. In defiance of its material form, the sculpture is a svelte vertical, raised upon a cylindrical base and tapering up to a point. Its pure essential lines have monolithic simplicity and playful levity. The work is the apotheosis of the dematerialized object. The Bird in Space is the iconic form of the scenario of Skaer's 2008 sculptural landscape, The Siege, first exhibited at the Chisenhale Gallery in London. Here appear 26 copies made by Skaer of the original work in its multiple versions. The birds are grounded, quite without base. As the title suggests, they are besieged. They are hemmed in behind a curved breeze block wall. The aggressors, diluvial forces, great waves evinced in drawn forms on paper, allegorical scenario intuited by Hokusai and Da Vinci, tumbling in, both as image on the surface of the wall and as drawing lain on the ground. Printed forms of the numeral zero signal time run out, that this is the moment of deluge, paused as freeze frame and dilated by the artist so that the viewer might walk in its midst. The viewing body circulates in this deluge painting imaginary become fraught, grounded scene. The critically reflexive forms of the birds are here changed. They are opaque, black, cast in coal dross. They are stacked, as described by the artist, as if become fuel in a siege situation of extremis, and in formation so that their missile-like forms become ammunition for firing. Yet should they fire, they shoot into impervious waves. they are glimpsed at the moment of engulfing by earthly great flood conditions, once intuited by theology, and beyond which the modernist bird as beacon of critical modernity circled. Skaer's scene could be a representation of a Heideggerian fear. It could be a critical vision, wherein art and the human imaginary, encapsulated in Brancusi's bird, are seen as standing resource, shipped like coal from the Ruhr and logs from the Black Forest, using Heidegger's words in his Origin of the Work of Art. It could be a scene of dire ontological crisis hinged on petrocapitalism, where all becomes fuel in the earth, exploited as object, unbalanced. Yet I do not read the work as a critical work, aiming to expose aestheticised art as become standing resource, or a catastrophic scene of the results of modern objectification of nature. Such an unveiling has no interlocution with catastrophic, insentient, diluvian forces. Instead, I propose that Skaer's work is a freeze-frame casting of the dilemma of art that engages in critical and epistemological mode and inquiry in the new current context of a metamorphosed earth system, accompanied by the recognition that the human imaginary has geological force. In naming this siege, in grasping a 20th century critical language of art that malfunctions, flightless, and misconceives its adversary, firing into waves, hemmed in behind an unscalable wall as rational epistemological limit, Skaer's art exactly extrudes itself from those limits. A dilemma is rendered, transformed as it is perceived, becomes scrutable by sleight of hand. Brancusi's forms are embodied, afforded a new weight, yet whilst it becomes fuel, sustenance and weapon, Skaer is channeling influences and primal geological forces quite antecedent to the nihilistic and objectifying modern phenomenon of inframing. Skaer's work is not a vision of art become standing resource, rather it is a vision steeped in a landscape tradition where the abstract capacities of the human imagination are grasped also as weighty geophysical material of deep and unseen origin. As a vision of a flightless bird, Skaer's The Siege bears resemblance to Paul Nash's 1936-8 painting Landscape from a Dream. Here the other grounded bird, a hawk, looks onto an airborne counterpart, flying amidst the abstraction of a painting within the painting. Skaer's sculpture contains a three-dimensional rendering of the screen, which functions in Nash's work to open a parameter between planes of the imaginary and geological reality, between the realm of the unconscious implied in the dreamscape of the work and the deep geological formations of the Dorset coast. In her references to Nash, Skaer taps a tradition which operates outside of the limits of critical modernity to make underdetermined ontological descriptions in the British landscape. Her work partakes in a fluid and dynamic play between dimensions. As a landscape artist impressioned by a local art history with close and experimental ties to the foundations of the discipline of geology, Nash was able to glean marvellous and universal implications of the newly understood radioactivity and age of the earth in his artistic activities. He quietly declined the modernist's imperative in favour of unbound adventures in the newly understood primordial land. Skaer's work too sees the terra incognita opened by new geological discovery and consciousness, I propose, irrespective of a self-limiting critical thought which is exemplified in a range of contemporary art practices addressing climate crisis, rests weightless with the question of the possibility of knowing geological condition. And Skaer recurrently flags the speculative adventure of her work, for example using the motif of the Ship of Fools, venturing out without a map, described in Sebastian Brandt's 15th century allegory, which also includes first references to the New World. Skaer's strong realism grasps the abstractions of art as part of a new geological age of the human, wherein art is subject to, yet also agent of geological force. Her birds have none of the ethereality of synthetic metal, but they have the depth and imperviousness of the geological. In confluence with a fulsome reading of new science statements, which perceive far more than a damaged earth system, I propose that Skaer's realism points to the abstractions of art and the human imaginary, or noosphere, the world of thought, as part of deep time reality. Skaer's oeuvre is laden with objects that are found in a landscape engaged by the artifice and abstractions of the human imaginary. The stones of a quarry used for lithographic limestone, an abandoned and boarded up set of cinema projectors, huge tranches of sinka mahogany fallen from British shipments, lain under mud in Belize for 100 years. These objects of two-dimensional image-based and decorative processes were forged with geological weight, stone quarried, hardwood trees felled, cast iron and steel shaped into immovably heavy projectors. These found inanimate objects have in each case been subjected to the rub of embodied forces, A quarry, Lithograph City, opened in extremis during World War and subsequently closed because it was inaccessible by railroad. Wood that is cut, sliced, swamped, buried and rediscovered, unearthed in the jungle. A projector rendered obsolete by new technologies, which was decommissioned and derelict inside its damp, dilapidated theatre, littered with droppings and debris. The modernist critic Roger Fry described the cinematograph as offering a curious glimpse of the opportunity of imaginative life that is offered by art. I quote, "Many objects in the world, when presented to our senses, put in motion a nervous machinery, which ends in some instinctive action. We see a wild bull in a field. Quite without our conscious interference, a nervous process goes on, which ends in the appropriate reaction of flight. The processes of natural selection have brought it about that the instinctive reaction, such, for instance, as flight from danger, shall be the important part of the whole process. But in the imaginative life, no such action is necessary, and therefore the whole consciousness may be focused upon the perceptive and the emotional aspects of the experience." End quote. Skaer's film for an abandoned projector waits Fry's abstracted imaginative life too, with all of its opportunity in the thick of reality itself, its processes of natural selection. Where the modernist imaginary thought itself free of the drivers of instinct and their implication in survival, Skaer's cinematographic unconscious, the film of the abandoned projector, turns at base on untold physical force and sensual drive. The film features footage of unclear provenance, heavy ripe peaches become windfall, buffeted by an approaching hurricane. Primordial rock and mineral crystal textures grated against the screen. The film reel itself, opaque white and red film leader, and the heavily sprung theatre door both feature. Real-time sunset footage, the glowing sun disappearing on the watery horizon, derives from the artist's Williamsburg studio, from across an ocean where the project was devised. As the light angles and fades, the shadows amidst film print sharpen and thicken. Heavy snooker balls roll across the screen in one scene. They seem to echo the movements of celestial spheres in Nash's landscape painting, which with wind behind them cast out into the real space of the viewer and by return become golden balls of harvested hay. Here, abstract form also has real function and force in the physical world. The blank sail of a boat taut with the force of an arcane wind. Tall ships set sail in footage that appears of unknown time, timeless. Fry's imaginative capacity and the human drive to abstract processes of perception is here apprehended as a force not independent of, but deeply written in the geological. It is marvellous imaginative capacity, driving force, alert to sustenance and survival, vessel and provisions. From another geological angle, Skaer's embodied perishable objects are swamped, abandoned, blown, shipped, cut off, but they are also vital signs. These found objects appear in time as signs of life, evidences. They are objects and tools of the imaginary, located in the deep time landscape, obsolete, abandoned, yet as tools and apparatuses of abstracted activities, they are indicative of a consciousness amidst geological reality. The imaginary is geologically bound, and yet so too the geological is newly bestowed. This geomorphic vitality is everywhere at work in Skaer's oeuvre. Its materials and postures, which channel a history of discerning vital animated design in the patterns and processes of the landscape. In writing of Nash's work and his illustrations of Thomas Brown's The Garden of Cyrus or the Quincunxial Lozenge, Herbert Reid used the words of a poet to characterise this life of the inanimate object in the terms of the mystical quincunx form. I quote, "In the earth below, in the water beneath the earth, in deity, in the mind of man, in bones, in the optic nerves, in roots of trees, in leaves, in petals, in everything." End quote. The quincunxial lozenge has a vital place in Skaer's work, its diamond and lozenge forms cut in lithographic stone, resins, suspending celluloid, in ceramic, terracotta, metal, mahogany. This life of the inanimate object too has the nimble wit and cunning, the improvisation of the harlequin. The quick thinking of birds transformed into ammunition for firing off the ground. Slabs of gold twisted into new forms in the dark of the night by unseen hands. A scene fled, a fast escape or a plotting band of objects caught in the act. Skaer channels the vitality and promise of the modernist. Her 2010 Rachel, Peter, Caitlin and John appears as a garden game where solid shapes in jade, pewter, porcelain or black wood are pushed in and out of the physical world. Skaer's work is alive with the play and language of children, a monoprint onto a wall by lifted table or chair, a battle siege with figures set to fight. The black alphabet of the schoolroom. The artist recalls Virginia Woolf's 1931 The Waves, a work in which children play and perform amidst a new dawn, learning language for as if the first time to describe their world. She cites a sentence of an early draft of Woolf's novel. I am telling the story of the world from the beginning and in a small room whose windows are open. And there is new material, sea-changed, repurposed, drained of visceral histories, blank slate, celluloid scratched to blank, salvaged hard wood. The clean, pure surface of white lithographic stone, once a wartime contingency, is cut, lifted, polished, clear, prepped. It becomes a set of stepping stones. These heavy, levered geological objects seemed hard to move, unwieldy, immobile, as if they would require rousing from some unconscious state, new motor skills to be developed. Yet they have an unexpected levity. Sinker wood flitches flip up and across continents for a surrealist game where a new casting in marble, stone, ceramic or plastic is added in each iteration. Derelict projectors fire up and bust out of a boarded up room. Carbon arc glowing, reels spinning. The artist flexes form, the reflexivity of which is not locked in abstraction or epistemological, it is ontological. The encounters of Skaer's works echo the embodied reflexivity encountered in new geological statements, which are far more than rhetorical description of an inanimate earth, damaged by human activity. In 2002, Crutzen referred to an anthropozoic era, in which a new telluric force which in power and universality might be compared to the greater forces of the earth, and the noosphere or world of thought, marking the growing role of human brain power in shaping its own future and environment. In a reflexive statement marking the discovery of human imaginative and physical activity as deep time geomorphic force. In a context where contemporary artists contemplate concepts of reality without thought, Skaer's works articulate a vital, full-blooded human imagination. A 2018 presentation of the artist's La Chasse is an elaborate arrangement of sculpted objects placed across the floor of the gallery in bronze, yew, copper, terracotta and crystal. The title refers to a scene in a 1379 book, Le Livre de Chasse, a treasure of medieval hunting literature, portraying human figures assembled for the occasion of the hunt, embedded and full to the page, with sure sense of environment and task. The figures are absorbed in and inseparable from their doings. The men work with instinct, attunement, drive and necessity. They're not distinguished in particular from the movements of the animals or the forms of the landscape. The hunt moves and hubbubs as one. It is a vision of the human enmeshed and absorbed at the centre of its indefinite reality. It carries intimations of its medieval pre-Copernican universe, the freight and significance of the centrality of the work of humans. Everywhere is the thick iron scent of blood, the rush of cortisol and adrenaline, the pumping hearts of the bounding humans and animals. The same exhibition assembled by the artist using the Edinburgh University collections included blood bled onto paper, extracted for experiment in coagulation time of the blood in man, a 1908 medical doctorate thesis. Elsewhere, a spread-eagled dermatome man implied the electrifying connectedness of skin, nervous system, colour, exterior, interior and time, the artist having painted walls of the gallery in the matched tones of the anatomical model, reconnecting sensation to the limbs of this uncovered figure, hitching material, activity and form of architecture, brushwork to cervical, thoracic, lumbar and sacral nerves. In counterflow with the original hunt scene, which transcribes saturated instinctive activity into two-dimensional account, Skaer presents the body and flesh of geometric form. Copper diamond is banding hair. Here the abstract, the significant form, its imaginative capacities, are seen as roundly embodied. Like Phoebus's image, La Chasse and the exhibition have the character of a guide to the hunt. In Skaer's work, evocative language is at work, where form follows suggestive word of title. Geometric shape becomes animal ear or red glass becomes pool of blood, for example. Here, language is felt in its embodiment, in visceral sculptural sentences describing weather conditions and palpable sightings, lifted in part from a 1785 weather almanac. Hot, dry and windy with violent thunder. In the yew woods, arrows rain down. Morning dew, the hare rests by marsh's pond. Hare darts for cover, the day is bright and open. I read in Skaer's works a foregrounding of the weighted and reflexive human imagination in a vision confluent with new statements of geological science. I quote Lewis and Maslin, defining the Anthropocene, Nature 2015. Past scientific discoveries have tended to shift perceptions away from a view of humanity as occupying the centre of the universe. In 1543, Copernicus's observation of the Earth revolving around the Sun demonstrated that this is not the case. The implications of Darwin's 1859 discoveries then established that Homo sapiens is simply part of the tree of life with no special origin. Adopting the Anthropocene may reverse this trend by asserting that humans are not passive observers of the Earth's functioning. To a large extent, the future of the only place where life is known to exist is being determined by the actions of humans. Yet the power that humans wield is quite unlike any other force of nature, because it is reflexive and therefore can be used, withdrawn, or modified. End quote. Skaer's ontological adventure in La Chasse is accompanied by the figure of the Green Man, who, in accord with the works of the exhibition titled The Same, is a figure where stone, tendril, and human amalgamate, moving, extruding, transforming as one. Skin and senses, leaf, plant, and medieval stone rendering coalesce, as do consciousness, geological, and organic life. The Green Man was a figure of renewal in the light of the plague. Skaer's prints of bracken and fern are lifted from The Ferns of Great Britain and Ireland. The volume contains detailed and physical knowledge of specimens, their differences and their fractal forms. I read Skaer's La Chasse as a vision of the human embedded at the centre of a vital reality, full-blooded, charged with intrigue. It is of an embodied intellect, playing, transcribing and synthesising forms across place, dimension, time and function, where even the weather might be abstracted, the forces of the wind and rain might be lifted, channeled, crafted. Skaer's 2018 quincunx is formed of lab-grown crystal. The human is only a part of reality, but the only part of reality that is reflexive. Skaer's images of ferns are supplemented with floating abstract graphic forms which sit behind the specimens and transform them by acts of playful iconoclasm. The artist makes her own Green Man. The pulled faces are as one of Wolf's children. The work is a plentiful new vision that still gleefully anticipates the next move. Where critically reflexive art is disarmed by a stark new geological reality, Skaer's art is able to find weight as part of that reality. Where contemporary realisms might reinforce a narrative of a damaged, inanimate earth, Skaer's strong realism finds objects that are vital signs. Where post-human reality without thought is lifted from the pages of apocalyptic science fiction, Skaer reasserts an adventurous vision replete with sustenance for the human imagination. Skaer's art quietly declines dominant Anthropocene narrative with its critical gate to experiment beyond the bounds of epistemology in the fulsome geological reality grasped by a new empirical data. It is a geological occasion. The day is bright and open.